Every once in a while, I get these fun little emails that are passed around all over the world, and you may have read this one or seen it, but I think it's really funny. It is an email that says, are you really a law-abiding citizen? And we all would say, of course we are. We're not in jail. We're law-abiding citizens. And we learn the law and we follow it. And then it goes on to give a few laws that probably you are not aware of. Like the law in Minnesota that says it's illegal in Minnesota to cross the state line into Wisconsin with a duck on your head. I ran into that one last month. Yeah. And in Iowa, it says it is a law that any one-armed piano player has to play for free. You know, when you're planning your next concert, you might want to make sure it's not going to be in Iowa or that you have both hands. This one wasn't in the email, but it was one that I have known from a long time ago in one of my history classes in high school, and the professor, the teacher, said that it's still on the books in Kansas that if two cars meet at an intersection at the same time, one cannot leave until the other's gone. So if you see another car coming up to the intersection, you might want to slow down and let them get there first and leave before you get there. Otherwise, you're stuck there for the rest of your life. The rest of your life. We have these laws on our books that were made for some good reason. I mean, I assume there was something about why you can't have a duck on your head. I don't know. But surely there was a reason for that law to be made, and it has long since passed that why would anybody make a law like that, you know? But they're still on the books. And if someone wanted to make it an issue, they could charge you if you were goofing around and carrying a duck on your head. But they're not the laws that are meaningful to us anymore, and they're not laws that apply to our lives. And so that's why they're funny, because we think, why could they still be there? Let's get rid of these silly things. But that's what happens with any organization throughout the years. That's what happens through any culture. You know, we go through changes of understandings and of people and things. I know in my hometown, there used to be a sign outside of town that says, no man, no black man in town after sundown. No black man in town after sundown. It said that's a nice version of what it said. But that's what the people believed at that time, that it was not good to let them in town after sundown. Agree with that, and the people of the town wouldn't agree with it now either, but at one time that was something they felt they needed to say. And if we were still followers of the law today, of these laws, life would be pretty silly, and they wouldn't be very meaningful at all. And that's what's happening in these three texts from that we have from Acts and John and Revelation. Acts and John and Revelation, all three of them are challenging the people that are involved, challenging the people of God to look further and understand further, to have a bigger perspective and get away from all these laws that bind you down and don't allow you to grow and understand. And so they have these stories. Peter, who was one of the great foundation people of the church, it was illegal. He knew, as a Jewish man, it was illegal in the church's eyes to eat, you know, pork and animals of cloven foot and all these other things. And so he wouldn't ever eat those. That you wouldn't if you were a good Jewish person. And yet, in this dream, he has this dream of this big white sheet coming down. And on that sheet are all these different kinds of animals. And all the ones that are not desired or clean by Jewish standards. And so the sheet comes down and God says to Peter, go ahead, Peter, kill and eat. And the first two times, Peter says, I can't do that. I'm a good Jewish man, and these animals have not been in my mouth since I was born. In other words, I'm sticking to the law. I'm sticking to the rules because I want to be considered a righteous person. But finally, the third time, he has the same dream, and God says, kill, eat, do not call anything that God proclaims as good, do not proclaim that it is dirty or unfit. Isn't that a good idea? If God says it's good, then don't stand around and debate the goodness and make rules against it. God says, if I say it's good, it's good. And so accept it and live with it. And prosper with it, and celebrate it. And so, about that time, six brothers come and invite Peter to go to a Gentile abode. A Gentile abode. And that is God pushing Peter out to get past his narrow-minded thinking to go into the Gentile world of other people who have different beliefs and different ways of living, and understanding that these are God's people too. These are God's people too. And then we have in the book of Revelation this wonderful, wonderful end to a story that tells us after all of this bad and good and bad and good and bad and good have happened through the book of Revelation, tells us now that everything is put in place, God is coming down to live with humankind. I saw a new heaven and a new earth and a new city, a new Jerusalem, coming down to be with man, with humankind. Now, it wasn't that God was just waiting, I don't think, that God was just waiting for humankind to get good enough. I think that God was watching and sharing and directing humankind, and once they put down all their fighting and struggles, they looked around at each other and thought, oh, life is better this way. Life is better when we're not arguing, when we're not fighting, when we're not judging and pointing out people who are good and people who are bad. And in the midst of discovering the goodness of life as people come together in God's love, in the midst of that, they discover that God is there. That God is there. Where does God live? God lives in the hearts and the presence of people who love one another. Because it's obvious. Now, it doesn't mean that God isn't present, you know, in hard times and all that stuff. But the ideal that the revelation of John is trying to get to here is that when you love one another, then my love is seen. When you love one another, my love is seen. And so what that does, it encourages us to look upon each other from a different point of view. Now, I'm sure that there's at least one person in this room who has an enemy. Okay? I won't ask you which one you are. But I'm sure that there's one of us or more who have an enemy or two, and whenever we think of that person, what happens? We start getting tight up here in our chest and, you know, get stiff in the back of our necks, and our thoughts start going to negative things and judgmental things. And if we see something bad happen, we automatically go to that person and blame them for the way the world is and all this stuff. And we do that automatically. We do that. All of us do that. And we find bad things about one person or another, and we rehearse that. We rehearse it over and over again. Whenever bad comes up, we rehearse how bad this person, how badly they've hurt me, how much injustice I have suffered because of them, and they have caused all this evil in the world. We rehearse, we rehearse, we rehearse, and they get worse and worse and worse, and so do we. But if sometime or another we can say, oh, good grief, I have hurt over this long enough. I have hurt over this long enough. I don't care what they've done. I don't even remember what they did. I just know I'm tired of this. And once one person can break the cycle and go to that person and be forgiving, be kind, and recognize them as a child of God, just like the other person is, the world begins to change right then. Change right there. The whole world begins to change. Because there's one situation where there's less negative energy in the world, and two people involved in changing their hearts and their minds and making things better. I have been in situations like that. I'm sure all of us have. I have been in situations that went on 20 years until finally I went back and said, this is ridiculous. Here I am, and here you are. Let's get over this. And it made a complete difference in the relationship between the two of us. And it made a complete difference in my feelings about going to the place where they live, going to the town where they live. It made a big difference in how I felt at holidays. It made a big difference in how I felt when I watched TV and saw stories about different situations where people weren't speaking to each other. And no longer did I sit there and say, they're right and they should apologize. I sit and I say, it would be nice when the time comes for them both to see beyond what tore them apart. And that's how God's home is revealed. When we can get away from the negative and start bringing the love for one another, then all of a sudden there is a new Jerusalem. There is a new heaven and a new earth, and God comes to live with God's people as soon as we learn to reach out to each other in love and gratitude and interest and support, and the list goes on. Let us begin to make a difference in the world.